Good evening. It was raining the last time I played here. When was it? Hey, everybody. Nice to see you. I gotta tell you, I look vaguely familiar. I just learned this is streaming right now. So there's even less chance I'll remember all the lyrics, but I'll start with something you might know. Got a rich man's dream. Want to swap my taxi on a limousine. Want to cash it in. Want to give it all away. Got a poor man's needs. Beans in the bucket and love in the sheets. And your sandy eyes. Making it all right. Something's calling on me. Don't know where I'm going. I don't know where I'm going. I got no place to be. Honey, keep me company. Woke peacefully in the town somehow in New Jersey in my mama's arms, rocking to the radio. I sing myself to sleep, apartment 4 in building G. Gotta lock the door, gotta hide the key. Oh, baby, I'm free. Don't know where I'm going. I don't know where I'm going. I got no place to be. Honey, keep me company. Famous man with an L.A. tan, a million fans, and a catamaran floating movie stars. Maybe one day I'll be a bum in the gutter with a bottle in my hand and your sandy eyes, making it all alright, making it all alright. Making it all Sunday news, I need my funny papers. Little orphan Nanny and me have a rendezvous with three, with Mary Worth and Dick Tracy. And my idea of time well spent is to cloth up at the picnic basket. We'll find a clearing in the wood. You can be Red Riding Hood. You may be bad, but you're so good. And my idea of having fun is laying naked in the sun with you. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Sunday clothes, I've had inspiration. We'll ride downtown on the D and have a window shopping spree. It may be grass, but it's free. And my idea of what to do is make in love with you on the avenue. Another tune of that very first album. Potted plants hanging down from the ceiling, creeping up my windowsill. The cats don't get on the window wind well. I'm a fool and I water them every day. Have some faith in what's his name. The deck is stacked, but just the same, I'd rather lose a hand of hearts, I swear. Water you every day. what's his name? The deck is stacked, but just the same, I'd rather lose a hand of hearts, I swear. Time to win a round of solidarity. So, how are y'all doing? Good. That's good. I'm glad. You're looking well. I'm still getting over my jet lag. I've only been here a few days. And normally it takes me like a full 2 weeks to remember all my lyrics. So there's no telling what's about to happen.
We can help you.
I am counting on that. This might sound strange given what I ostensibly do for a living, but I've always felt a little bit uncomfortable in like large social gatherings. Not gigs. Gigs, I love doing these gigs. I'm talking about like, I don't know, family get-togethers or cocktail parties. Not that I've ever actually been invited to a cocktail party, but. But here's the reason being is because inevitably someone will come up to me and ask, "So, Dean, what do you do for a living?" Reasonable question, but what you have to appreciate is this is a tough question for any musician to answer. Because even on those rare occasions where we might actually be making a living, you know, we all do other things. I design video games. I write, build books, and build strange musical instruments. Anyway, it's just a tough question to answer. What do you do for a living? Especially awkward when my wife asks me, Dean, what do you do for a living? And here's the thing, she's a good gal, and I figure she deserves a real reasonable reply to that question. So I've thought about it, I've come up with what I think is a good response. I'd like to share it with you. And also offer it up to, you know, any folks here may be in similar circumstances. We still have this really precarious economy. So if you're temporarily out of work between gigs, or if, like me, you're just plain fucking lazy, this song might come in handy. Feel free to use it. This is what I answer to that question. Everybody wonders just what is it that I do. They scratch their heads and speculate, but they don't have a clue. Though I may seem unemployed, that's not exactly true. I do some part-time work, but honey, my main job is loving you. It's my job to make you happy. It's my job to make you smile. It's my job to take you in my arms and hold you for a while. It's my job to make you feel good, and I'm never gonna stop. Well, it's my job to love you, honey, and I love my job. It works. Well, I went to my accountant to do my taxes like you do. When he asked my occupation, I filled in, loving you. Well, I'm suited to my vocation, just like good old Captain Kirk. I never will retire, 'cause I'm addicted to my work. It's my job to make you happy. It's my job to make you smile. It's my job to take you in my arms and hold you for a while. It's my job to protect you from the littlest raindrop. Well, it's my job to love you, honey, and I love my job. Well, I never finished high school, but I found a fine career. Money's not that good, but honey, that's not why I'm here. 'Cause where else could I spend all my time whispering sweet nothings in your ear? And if I never get paid a penny, honey, I'll still volunteer. It's my job to make you happy. It's my job to make you smile. It's my job to take you in my arms and hold you for a while. It's my job to care about you, 'cause you make my heart throb. Well, it's my job to love you, honey, and I love my job. Well, the terms of my employment are quite favorable, it's true. With benefits and bonuses like spending time with you. And I never have to worry about things like job security. 'Cause as long as I keep loving you, you'll keep loving me. It's my job to make you happy. It's my job to make you smile. It's my job to take you in my arms and hold you for a while. It's my job to make you feel good, and I'm never gonna stop. Well, it's my job to love you, honey, and I love my job. Yes, it's my job to love you, honey, and I love my job. Yes, it's my job to love ya, honey, and I love my job. Now, this next song is something I wrote when I first started attending university. The City College of New York in New York City in Manhattan. But that first semester, I was still living home where I grew up in Paramus, New Jersey. So I had to commute every day by bus across the George Washington Bridge into Manhattan through the bus station there. And there was a population of homeless women who pretty much resided in the bus station, surrounded by all their stuff. They were very proud, very defiant. They didn't want anyone feeling sorry for them. In fact, if you said anything remotely nice, they would promptly curse at you and give you a finger. They had a lot of attitude. The shopping bag ladies, they live in the terminal waiting room, patiently whiling their hours away, desperately keeping their demons at bay, making up lies about times that were good, extolling the virtues of motherhood, staunchly defending their sanity, clutching one last shred of vanity, fixing a kerchief she wears in her hat, covered in posies and lilacs and blues and in reds. Don't pity me, don't pity me, you beautiful bastard boy. I'll be just how I am. I'll be just how I am. Shopping bag ladies, it's not the all, but they're really in vogue. Latest in fashion, the taste is so true. Sweat socks and sneakers, a sweater or two. And safely behind the walls they have made, secure in their brown paper barricades, worldly possessions will not have to lose lightweight emotional refuse. And they rave, they're mad and they're crazy, and that's how they stay. Freedom, pity me, don't pity me, you beautiful bastard boy. I'll be just how I am. I'll be just how I am. Shopping bag ladies, it's hard to believe, but once they were children. This next song is something that I wrote a while, well, 2016 is when I wrote it, when I noticed that a bunch of friends from Ireland were posting online about the what was then the 100th anniversary of what's called the Easter Rising. a failed uprising in Ireland, but it presaged much to come. But you have to appreciate, as an American, my sense of history goes back maybe 10 years. And so in the process of kind of educating myself about this event, I came upon what's apparently a true story that occurred the week of the Easter Rising in 1916. In a little park in Dublin. If you've ever been to Dublin, there's this beautiful little park called St. Stephen's Green. And it's filled with tree-lined paths and a couple of small little ponds that are filled with ducks. Anyway, as this story is relayed, the Irish Citizens Army was trying to kick the British troops out of the park and not having much success with it. But in the midst of all this fighting, a gamekeeper, a guy named James Kearney, he did something that you might consider either incredibly brave and bold or amazingly stupid. He stood in the middle of the park with a white flag, and he beseeched both sides to stop fighting long enough for him to feed his ducks. And incredibly, they agreed. And so once every afternoon for a week, both sides, they put down their weapons, stop killing each other, and let James Kearney feed his ducks. Anyway, the story made an impression on me, because it suggests that even in the midst of insane warfare and fighting and killing, which always seems to go on and on, but that still, that inside everyone is a hint, a spark of wanting to be peaceful, of wanting to do no harm, and even if it's to a bunch of ducks. So this is the true story of the ducks of St. Stephen's Green. Let me tell you a story of bravery and glory, a tale that's both true and surprising. About a muddle in the middle of a puddle in Dublin, in the week of the Easter Rising. Oh, really? Tell him I'll call him back. Okay. So yeah, if you could silence your phones. Actually, you know what? Thanks for reminding me. All right. With your permission, I'm going to start that again. Let Let me tell you a story of bravery and glory, a tale that's both true and surprising. Of a muddle in the middle of a puddle in Dublin, in the week of the Easter Rising. In the week of the Easter Rising. It was 1916 in St. Stephen's Green, in the Irish Citizens' Army was defending the square from the British troops there. Fighting grew savage and stormy, as the fighting grew savage and stormy. Well, the bullets were flying, and soldiers were dying, when a gamekeeper named James Kearney said, I'd rather retreat, but my ducks have to eat. There's no knowledge of freedom or tyranny. They've no knowledge of freedom or tyranny. So he took a bold stand, a flag in his hand. Hold your fire, he shouted and pled. And then to his surprise, both sides heeded his cries as his ducks waddled over to get fed. As his ducks waddled over to get fed. There were mallards and muscovies, cresteds and blues. There were harlequins, pintails and widgeons. There were wingnacks and pekins and buffalo heads too, and a handful of seagulls and pigeons. A handful of seagulls and pigeons. And then each afternoon, every squad and platoon held their fire and laid down their arms. As the gamekeeper tended his ducklings and ducks, not a feather on their heads did they harm. Not a feather on their heads did they harm. So step left, step right, my fine feathered friends. Let your web feet guide you, but make haste as you waddle and flap, as you paddle and quack. There's a war being waged beside you. There's a war being waged beside you. That, the true story of the ducks of St. Stephen's Green. Although I have to confess, I did add a few ducks that don't actually live in those ponds. And I think his name is pronounced James Carney, but that didn't rhyme with tyranny. That's called poetic license. All right. This next song requires a little bit of explanation. It all started a while back. I was in New York preparing to come over here for another tour, as I do. And I got a call from a good friend in London, Andy. And he says, Dean, there's something here you need to know about. And I said, well, okay, what's up? And he goes, well, there's a band outside of Liverpool named Half Man, Half Biscuit. Many of you know this legendary punk band. Now, it was the first I'd ever heard it. I said, well, that's a funny name for a band. And he said, Dean, that's not the funny part. I said, okay, what's the funny part? He goes on to explain. He said, well, they have a best-selling EP, and there's a track on it that's titled The Bastard Son of Dean Friedman. Now, like many of you, I was skeptical of this claim. It just didn't seem likely, and I just, you know, I figured he's just pulling my leg, and so I just ignored it and dismissed it from my mind until I landed at Heathrow Airport to kick off a new tour. And he met me there at the airport with the EP in hand. And fuck me. There was the title, The Bastard Son of Dean Friedman. At which point I confess to growing a little bit nervous. After all, I mean, I'm Dean Friedman. And I grew increasingly concerned until I finally sat down and did the math. And I calculated, in order for me to have fathered this guy, Nigel Blackwell, lead singer and songwriter for Half Man, Half Biscuit, I would have had to have done so when I was 7. Now, granted, I was a precocious child, but not that precocious. So greatly relieved, I finally sat down and listened to this track. Let me tell you, it's hilarious. In fact, I urge you, when you go home tonight, open up YouTube, type in The Bastard Son of Dean Friedman, and you'll be able to hear this amazing ode. Because Nigel Blackwell is a terrific songwriter. Half Man, Half Biscuit are a kicking band. But folks, even then I swore that one day I would exact my revenge. And so I have, and so I'd like to share for you tonight the hitherto untold tale of the dubious origins of one Nigel Blackwell, of Half Man, Half Biscuit. Once there was a humble baker, spent all day making buns and cakes, and rolls and loaves of bread and muffins. Loved his work, but it wasn't enough. He longed to offer up his heart to not just any tart, but one of substance and of virtue, but suitable candidates for roast of few. Oh, Nigel Blackwell, pray please do tell, how could your parents risk it? Baker's son, born of a bun, half a man, half a biscuit. Yep. He gently took her from the oven. Sweet scent set off waves of loving. His eyes beheld her flaky crust. He thought, I mustn't, but I must. Alas, Nigel's dad could not resist her. He held her close and then he kissed her. Or another word was uttered, his mama's buns were buttered. Oh, Nigel Blackwell, pray please do tell, how could your parents risk it? Baker's son, born of a bun, half a man, so please mark this poignant tale. Next time you see baked goods for sale, which proves true love defies convention and leads to couplings we can't mention, and so it comes as no surprise, the needy baker's dough did rise. Cause some may scoff to right and scorn from such forbidden love, Nigel was born. Oh, Nigel Blackwell, pray please do tell. How could your parents risk it? Baker's son born of a bun. Half a man.
Half a biscuit.
Half a man. Half a biscuit. Any questions?
Have you seen it?
I've met Nigel and the band. They're really great guys. And in fact, they invited me to play that song at a gig they did a while back in Wolverhampton, the Robin. I was a little nervous because, you know, the fans are a lot of these big blokes. But by the second chorus, they were all singing along. And then at the end of the show, they invited me back onto the stage to join them for a rousing rendition of The Bastard Son of Dean Friedman. Which was... Nigel said his mom really liked the song. Keeps my toothbrush in her apartment. She never complains. Hardly ever. And then jokingly she says, "Boy, it's been so long since I've held you. I nearly gave you up for dead. I nearly gave you up for dead. I nearly gave you up for dead." I can offer you nothing at all. This is more than I had planned. Lydia, Lydia, I'm at your command. At least until morning comes. Then I must be off again. I must be off again. You know, I always talk about conscious decisions, about running my own life. Maybe I'm fooling myself, it's a role I like to play. Cause more often than not, I'm down here on the corner. I'm sorry I woke you. You feel like some company, babe, I need a place to stay. Understand, I can offer you nothing at all. This is more than I had planned. Lydia, Lydia, I'm at your command. At least until morning comes, then I must be off again. I must be off again. I'm a child, maybe I am. Now that wouldn't surprise anyone. I suspect that much is true. But Lydia, if you only knew how much I love you. Did you know that I love you? It's the best that I can do. I can offer you nothing at all. This is more than I had planned. Lydia, Lydia, I'm at your command. must be off again. I must be off again. I'm going to do another tune and then take a little bit of a break so you guys can stretch your legs. But then I'll be back in a little bit. But if you'll indulge me for a brief commercial announcement. Let's see here. I schlepped all this stuff from Peekskill, New York, and I don't want to bring it back. So I got too much stuff, which I'd be obliged if you take some of this off my hands. And let's see what I got. I got all kinds of paraphernalia. Of course, there's the 12-inch vinyl, reissued, remastered. So you might want to take one of these home with you. And there's CDs of it as well. And in fact, there's a songbook of "Well Was It the Rocking Chair," so with chords and lyrics. And in fact, when I forget the words to some of these songs, I consult this songbook. I should probably leave it right up here. And let's see. Also, I'm going to play some tracks in the next set, some tunes off of the brand new album, "American Lullaby." Thank you. So I got some of these as well. And, you know, people at the end of the gig, they say, oh, I got that CD, I got that CD, I got that CD. So I thought, oh, well, let me get some that they don't have. So I have an American Lullaby tote bag, which you can stuff all the CDs that you have in here. And so during the interval, if you want to just check out by the entrance, there's a little table way down low with all that stuff. Everything's like 20 quid, and cash is preferred, but if you don't have cash, because you all have very trusting faces, I work on the honor system, which is that you could take whatever you like, and as long as you write down what you took, the amount, and your name, email address, and phone number, just in case I can't read your email address, then I'll send you an invoice online, and you can pay it after the fact. Simple as that. Any questions, I'll be there at the end of the show to answer questions and to scribble on almost anything. But here's another tune from this album here, which I wrote one evening in what you might call an herbal state of mind. And my empty apartment on West 72nd Street, there was no furniture. There was a piano in the middle of the room and a mattress on the floor to sleep on, and that's pretty much it. But as a young musician starting out in the city, I was pretty content. But there was that one night when I looked up. And I saw furniture. And what's more, the furniture started talking. Now, normally this would be cause for alarm. But in this instance, it gave me what I still consider to be pretty good advice. Well, else had the rocking chair? It's been a while since I've seen such stark despair. Who told you life was fair? Whoa, said the radio, said there's some things you ought to know. There's little you can do to stop the pain, and it's gonna happen time and time again. So just remember, even though it sounds insane, it's impossible to ever balcony. If it's pity you want, don't come to me. No, nothing comes for free. Yes, yes, said the coffee cup. Maybe now is the time to act grown up. Feel like your world is crashing in. Simply dial up your nearest guest again. You open up and let them in. You'll discover that you probably make it through once again. All right, it's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right. Hey, hey, said the tabletop. Don't be making like you're anything you're not. Make it with what you got. Don't forget, said the cuckoo clock. Any parts you need, we've got in stock. Take a look at the place you call your home. You're reflected in all the things you own. And the seeds of reason you have sown. They're a measure of a part of you that's already grown. All right, it's gonna be all right. 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 It's gonna be in a bit.